Hi, welcome to FilmTracks, episode 16, I believe we are at.
16 weeks. I can't believe it. Jessie and I have a very special guest today, and I think we can think of him as three different guys. On one hand, we should introduce him as a film composer. On the other hand, we could introduce him as a lead guitarist for a band called Yes. And the third, we could introduce him as a solo guitarist who produces his own solo records. Trevor Rabin is here on our show, so don't go anywhere. We have a great one in store for you.
Hosting and bandwidth for Trigla is provided by Media Temple.
That's it, band, I guess.
Welcome, episode 16 of FilmTracks. If this is the first time that you're tuning into us, Jessie and I usually talk about the relationship between sound and image, whether that be film score or rock music, or anything in between. Today we have a very special guest with us. Trevor Rabin is here. Thank you so much for coming.
It's great to be here.
So, you know, one of the things that is like so kind of overwhelming for me, especially with you being here, is that you have a huge amount of work under your belt. And part of the hard part about preparing for this was figuring out kind of what to talk about. But you have a huge repertoire of music, and I think talk a little bit about where you came from, your background, and where you got started in film composing, or how you got to where you are now.
Well, the film composing thing was really quite a interesting story, because I'd done, I don't know, close to 1,000 shows with Yes and numerous albums, toured all over the world, and I decided we were playing Hiroshima, and I just thought, you know, I love doing this, but I've just played these songs so much, I want to take a break. And I said to my assistant, who's still working with me, I think it was in 1993, 94, I said, I just need a break from this. And, you know, I'd schooled somewhat in extensively in orchestration and arrangement. And I thought, I think I'm going to do film. Really naively, because I didn't know what hurdles there would be. I just thought,
you were just interested in it?
I just would like to do film. And I got back to LA and I started thinking really seriously about it. And my wife and I happened to be at a restaurant which was co-owned by Steven Seagal. And someone told him I come to the restaurant frequently, and the maitre d' came to me and said, Mr. Seagal knows you come to the restaurant and really would like you to sit with him and give him a guitar lesson.
How random is that?
Okay,
you know. You don't
want to
mess with that guy.
No, yeah. So if you don't touch me, I'll come do it.
Exactly.
And he'd been playing guitar for years. And, but I went in, spent a couple of hours with him, and he said to me at the end, thank you so much. You know, anything I can do for you, just let me know. You know, if there's anything I could do, I'd love to help in any way. Because I'd mentioned I was thinking of getting into, and I said, well, I really do want to do film score, so if you had any, want to get into film scoring, if you have any one you would recommend, with be it an agent or whatever, I really didn't know how it worked. I'd be, you know, that would be great. And he just very nonchalantly said, well, I just finished a movie if you want to do it.
Just like that?
Just like that. Yeah. And I said, yeah. And that was it. And I did the movie, and
what movie was it called?
Glimmer Man.
Okay.
And at the premiere, someone from Jerry Bruckheimer's office was there, and I obviously don't exactly know what happened, but apparently told Jerry the score's really interesting, and next thing I was doing Bruckheimer movies.
Mm-hmm. Which, so that was the entrance.
He makes like a couple, you know, one or two.
Yeah, I've done 13 with him. Lucky 13.
Mm-hmm. That's crazy. That's amazing. So you grew up in South Africa,
right?
You were saying,
right?
And you had joined a band when you were younger at that point, in your early 20s.
Yes, yes. Actually, the band started really moving from when I was about 20 But the three of us in the band had been playing together since we were 15 years old. And we hadn't, the band's name at that time wasn't Rabbit, it was something else, but we were playing bar mitzvahs and socials and all kinds of things.
What was the music scene like at that time in South Africa?
It was very cover version-y. There was really no original band. All the original music wasn't really considered very seriously.
Huh.
And in fact, Rabbit was, I think, the first time really that it was considered and did well and sold. And the band was kind of a, I think we sold more posters than records. So,
how long were you with Rabbit? How long was Rabbit in?
3 years.
Okay.
3 years. And then we were having real problems being South Africa, apartheid South Africa, mm-hmm. getting permits and stuff. And I just decided after a while that, you know, we'd really saturated the South African market. And I left the band and went to London to try it out there.
And what happened when you went to London?
No one knew who the hell I was.
So how did you develop, like, what did you do next?
I was writing all the time. I got a record deal with Chrysalis Records, who were fantastic. I did three albums with them. I started producing a lot of acts, and cut a long story short, I produced Manfred Mann, David Geffen was talking to Manfred at the time. That didn't work out, but I met David Geffen, and he landed up inviting me to move to LA and write to eventually do an album, which I came over, and 6 months later my idea of what I should do was I wanted to do a solo album, he wanted me to join a band, so I said I didn't want to do that, and he dropped me, and 2 months later 90125, that material was a Yes album, so maybe I should listen to it.
So, in the case, those of you, see, this is kind of awesome because I didn't know that, I mean, when I first heard of your name, I only knew you as a film score composer.
Right.
Growing up and watching Armageddon and Gone in 60 Seconds, you know, and you buy the records and it says Trevor Rabin on there.
Right.
But then, if you hear the Yes song, for example, like Owner of a Lonely Heart,
mm-hmm.
everybody knows that song. Like, I mean, you're guaranteed to know it, and it's just, like, amazing that you were in that band and you mm-hmm. were the lead guitar. Did you write that song?
Yes, yes.
That's very, very cool.
Did you solo write, like, all of the songs, or was it more?
Yeah, they were. Once the Geffen thing fell through, I had all this material, and I thought, well, I'm going to do a solo album. Mm-hmm. I was really motivated mm-hmm. and spoke to great record guy Ron Fair, who has landed up, was until recently the chairman of Geffen, ironically.
Mm.
But he was at RCA at the time, and he really wanted to sign me to RCA. And then Atlantic wanted to sign me to Atlantic. And I somehow landed up with Atlantic, and Chris Squire, the bass player of Yes, and Alan White, the drummer, also wanted to put something together, because Yes had disbanded a couple of years before.
Mm-hmm.
And we started playing together, and started recording the album, and wasn't too long before it changed to Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's amazing. So in case you guys who are watching don't know what this song is, I'm going to play maybe 30 seconds of Owner of a Lonely Heart so you can check it out. I guarantee you've heard it before, so let's hear a clip from this Yes album.
Move yourself.
So very awesome track.
Thank you.
Very, very cool, obviously. Very, very cool. And so once you left Yes, or once Yes mm-hmm. disbanded and you started making these solo records, mm-hmm. Talk a little bit about this new record that you have out and like the style of play that you actually perform. Is there a specific style that you would consider yourself in terms of a guitar player? I know there are very, very different styles of playing.
Yeah, it's very, very, it goes from one extreme to the other. It's an instrumental album, obviously, mm-hmm. but I think one of the reasons I got to do this album is after Yes, I spent so many intense years on film scores. I think that kind of filtered into my thinking musically. And but I also, because when I'm scoring film, I'm not playing as much guitar as I would be with Yes.
And that's your passion? Is that your passion?
Certainly one of them. One of the main passions I have. Mm-hmm. Probably one on the list.
Have you ever tried to incorporate your guitar playing into your film scores?
Yeah, I was doing that a lot. Mm-hmm. But obviously it was never the lead instrument. Mm-hmm. So this album seemed to be a kind of natural progression from scoring. But I didn't go into this album initially thinking I was going to do an instrumental album. I just knew that I was going to be doing something that, for me, that I would like.
Like a personal...
Very selfishly I was going to do it, with no thought to release or... In fact, I didn't even get into discussing a record deal until it was long after it was done.
I mean, it got released on Barrise, which is like a great label.
Yeah, who I have a great relationship with, so it was really a good fit.
Yeah.
And it's just been incredible.
So one of the things I noticed about, and Jessie actually picked this as one of her favorite songs on it, is that mm-hmm. there's the Guardian theme. You redid the Guardian theme.
Yes.
Which a lot of the fan, I know that there are a lot of fans, score fans, that love that movie and love the music in it. Mm-hmm. So what made you want to include that on your solo record?
Well, a lot of the playing is, especially on the more kind of fusion stuff, is very intense mm-hmm. and a lot of... peculiar times, meters and changes, and I just thought it would be nice in the middle of the album to have like a palate cleanser and just
kind of like
chill out.
An intermission.
Yeah, yeah. And it always, when I finished writing that, it always hit me emotionally. I was very content with the feeling I got from it.
And there's an artist you worked with on this. On mm-hmm. this specific song, Liz Constantine.
Yes.
And had you worked with her before The Guardian, or was she?
Yeah, we've done quite a lot of stuff together. I'm just trying to think where else. The Exorcist was one.
The Exorcist Beginning, is that
yes,
the one?
Yes, yes.
Scary movie.
A scary movie. And there's, I can't remember, but quite a lot we've worked together, and she's just great to work with. Amazing. Incredible intonation and just style. I mean, she really uses her voice as an instrument. You know, you don't need lyrics, you know. She just can sell a melody.
Is it kind of like, she reminded me a little bit of like Lisa Gerrard a little bit, how she uses her vocals to really just intensify a theme or intensify a note?
Yeah, she wouldn't agree with that, but I know what you're saying.
Don't
you
know
what
say
I
mean? That to her.
Yeah. I will not say that
no,
to her.
No, don't say that to her.
I apologize if you're watching. But musically, I think it...
No,
I think there's a similarity.
I hear what you're saying, yeah. Using the voice as an instrument. Mm-hmm. I think that's clearly something she does so great.
So before we start getting into clips, because I think this album is very rad, it's an amazing album.
Thank you.
I mean, you obviously are extremely good at playing guitar. And,
thank you.
You know, it's just, I mean, I was watching some clips on YouTube and it was just like amazing seeing you just, you know, play this guitar, like, making it look easy.
Mm-hmm. It is easy.
Give me a guitar, I'll show you. It's like, so is there an overall theme for the entire album, for all of the songs as a unit, or is every one of them have a different story?
You know, to me it's musically and mostly from a guitar point of view and a piano point of view.
Just you play those piano as well?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, I did all I didn't do drums other than that, I did the stuff.
All the instrumentation.
But it was like just an exploration of those two instruments leading and searching and going to all different places without any concern about demographic or you know, because stylistically, if you go, for example, Rescue, which is the track from The Guardian, to a song like Into the Tunnel. I mean, it sounds like it's from different continents.
My favorites, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, with that, it's...
It's a very good range on the album. And I will say that I think our listeners would probably enjoy it due to the fact that it's, like, an instrumental album. I wouldn't necessarily recommend it to the casual radio top 40 listener.
Sure. Right,
But for film geeks, for film score geeks,
and,
they could
get
into it.
And, you know, audiophiles, too. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, if you play this record on, like, a good system and you're in a room and you have, like, a pair of good Meridian speakers or something, you know, some good Genelec speakers... And you're listening. I mean, it just there's such a great range of sound coming from the guitar.
And you know, that was one of the great things about Verez. The minute we did this, they said we've got to go and got to release it on. There's a special.
It's like HD.
Yeah,
like,
some HD tracks. I can't.
So it's
remember
like a 5.1 mix.
It's not 5.1, but it's done at 48K and. It's really high resolution, and it really sounds great the way what they've done with it.
I wonder if that's like a Blu-ray. If they do, if it's like, do they have Blu-ray DVDs? I mean, like audio CDs.
I mean, no one buys CDs.
That's right. Nobody buys. Nobody
but the analogies, I think, is
it's
pretty
HD,
accurate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, is there a specific one? Do you want to start with one of the ones that you picked, like Through the Tunnel, just to give people a feel? It says that this one's featuring Vinny
Caliuta.
Caliuta. So who is that?
He's I think one of the best drummers in the world. I mean, he's just ridiculous. And I approached him because I've always loved his playing, but I'd never met him. And I approached him and he said, oh, I'd love to do it. And he came in and I sent him the track and two tracks he played on. And when he came in, I thought, well, you know, I'd put aside the morning or the afternoon, whatever it was, to go through them. He nailed it. Just within 10 minutes, he was like, okay, well, I guess we're done.
Yeah,
he's just
lunch?
So good, yeah. Yeah, there's three really good drummers on the album. It's one of the highlights for me.
Yeah, it's like amazing because you get to work with such seasoned professionals.
Right, and my son plays on two tracks, which was
definitely a big
highlight.
Talk about this a little bit more, but your son is on tour right now. He's
right.
And he played at Coachella, and he's all over the world.
Letterman and Conan, he's doing... Leno next week. A band called Group Love.
Yeah, I love that band. They're great.
Great.
Yeah, they're doing very well.
Yeah.
They're on Atlantic.
Yes, that's right.
Very awesome. And so, is he going to... We have to have him on our show.
Oh, absolutely. It's when he's back in town. Definitely.
Okay, well, let's check this out. And in fact, one of the ones that Jesse picked was Me and My Boy, which has your son on it. So we'll play that.
Cool.
We'll play that next. So let's listen to this track. It's called Through the Tunnel, and it's with Vinny... Caliuta. And it's from your recent album, which was released last month, right?
Yes.
And it's called Jacaranda. Did I
Correct.
Say that right?
Okay. Correct.
Let's check it out. Here we go. Thank you. So, really awesome track. And we were just talking about how it's just, Jessie was just saying how that's like awesome rock influence there, and it's like totally badass. So talk a little bit about like how would something like this be recorded? Like, did you have an idea of where you wanted to go, and then you just kind of like go with some sort of, do you know where to start, and then you just go with it? Or do you kind of...
Do you write everything?
Yeah,
like,
do you
to the
write
T,
everything?
Are you improvising?
Well, it's obviously a romantic track. Mm-hmm. I'm just kidding.
Romantic dinner.
Yeah. It's an interesting question because it obviously evolves and grows. But I think I had a pretty specific idea of what I wanted to do. But the end result turns out always to be something, not if not completely different, certainly something that sounds different to what... I've never ever actually had an idea, done it, and it turned out exactly the way I first heard it. Sometimes for better, sometimes for worse.
What about this track? Was it
for better?
For better?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
And
I think large part of that is because Vinny's influence was
the collaborative effort.
I mean, he just kicks your butt, you know.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. So, the next track I think we should play is "Me and My Boys." Talk a little bit about this track and how it, the genesis of it.
I approached my son and I said, I know you're busy, and he said, yeah, you're also busy. I said, yeah, but I'd really like
you. You're both rock
stars. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Let's just jam. Yeah.
And I said, you knew I was doing the album, and although there was no, as I told you, there was no brief or specific thing I was going to do with the record. Mm-hmm. I was just recording and having fun. And I said, I'd really like you to play on some of it. And... he said, play me the track. I played it to him. I said, all right, let's go through it. I want to explain, you know, there's some time signature things. I just need to go through it with you, and then we can go and record. He said, why don't you just play it to me, and I'll just play. And I said, no, it's not that kind of a song. It's not House of the Rising Sun, you know. You're going to have to really listen to it, study it.
I'm your father. Listen to me.
Exactly.
Do as I say.
And he did literally come in, I think, three takes. It was done. He just...
Like, so he nailed it too.
Completely, yeah. And the title came afterwards, mm-hmm. you know, but it was just great playing with him.
So did you do that a lot when he was growing up? Did you play a lot with each other?
No, he would come to a lot of Yes shows. And then I'll never forget Madison Square Garden, my assistant, who's obviously a very close friend of mine, mm-hmm. my roadie, said, okay, your dad's got to change his guitar now. Take him this guitar and take the other one back. And the look in his eye was terror, but I think that's where he got the first bug.
Mm-hmm. He was like, I gotta do this.
I think there's something deep inside that stuck from that moment.
Huh.
But he's been doing it for a long time, and you know, he went to USC, got his degree. And
in music?
And he really wanted to be a producer. I mean, Group Love met in Crete on some kind of artistic retreat. Hmm. He met these people. And he came back and said to me, I've got this thing, I really want to produce it. I think we've been writing together, I think it's pretty strong. Can the band come and stay at the house for a couple of days? Or stay at the house, thinking a weekend. And 3 months later, Group Love was released. So
that's awesome. So you grew up in a musical family?
Yeah, my father was a tremendous violinist. He was the first chair in the Johannesburg Symphony Orchestra for 15 years.
Wow.
My mother was a piano teacher, licentiate. She was a phenomenal pianist. My brother's a violinist, great violinist, but became a lawyer. And my sister's
Did he still play, though?
No, he doesn't play anymore.
Oh, that's sad.
Yeah, I know. And my sister's a good pianist and a great ballet teacher.
Wow, so it definitely runs through your family.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you pick...
I was the black sheep doing rock and roll.
But did you pick it up kind of by ear, or did you study under your parents?
I think I knew really early on, like in my 7, 8 years old, that my ear was pretty good. Mm-hmm. And but there was no option of not studying. You know, if you're born into that family, you start piano at 5 years old, and then you start orchestration when you're 15. It was just a set thing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it was banged into you.
Very academic.
Yeah.
Like structured.
Very much so.
Did that influence the way that you think about certain projects or creative ideas now?
I'm sure it is. I mean, the funny thing is I never ever had a guitar lesson. I taught myself a guitar basically from piano, So all the exercises that you would normally have to, you know, get your chops together, I used those on guitar. So I think it led me to approaching guitar in a slightly different way. Mm-hmm.
Which in a more unique way.
A little more rhythmic versus melodic.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
So, and I think orchestrally, although I studied it, being in rock bands all my life, that also influenced it away from being a kind of orthodox orchestrator.
Right, orthodox is a good word for it. Right, cool. Well, let's check out this clip, or this track, Me and My Boy, which features your son.
Yep.
So let's hear it. So another awesome track, it was super fun to make.
Yeah, that was tremendously enjoyable.
So you were talking a little bit about when I was playing that you actually had a hard, like it's hard for you to keep up with actually playing, right?
Well, that track in particular, because it's a very, it's a circular, it goes round and round. It changes, but the right hand keeps going in. You know, so it's just because you're not moving in different ways. It's very robotic in playing. That's it. After 3 minutes, it's at the end of the track. I've got a number of takes where at the end of it, you just hear,
you're like, oh, get me some aspirin.
Waiting for it to be over. Just like keep going.
Well, right on. Okay, so I think to end our discussion of this album, which by the way, if you're interested in it, I definitely recommend you check it out. It's on iTunes. But I think for the audiophiles out there, you should buy the CD. I don't know if they've released an HD version, if Aris has released the HD version of this.
They have. I'm not very familiar with how and the marketing and the whole thing, I know it's available.
Well, I know that iTunes wasn't iTunes like rumored to have like HD, some sort of HD tracks or digital files, like they were doing something.
I'm not sure.
Well, maybe that's
the quality of iTunes always bothers me.
Yeah, that's the problem. It's like even for orchestral stuff, it's like it drives me nuts. Like
the hard copy just sounds better.
It does. So, I think to end, we should listen to Rescue, which has Liz Constantine, and I know all you score fans that are watching right now can appreciate this because it's from The Guardian, which is one of the best scenes in the movie, and it's a very heart wrenching scene. I won't ruin it for those of you who haven't seen it. But one of the things that you were talking about before the show was that it kind of started out different, right? And then molded into kind of the very similar, very similar notation, or had a very similar theme by the end of it.
Yeah, when I decided to do it on the album, my idea for it was, you know, the Japanese disaster had just happened, and it was really a kind of tribute, or you know, it was full. Was inspired by that, and so I really wanted to change it and make it different. And I redid it all and came to a very different kind of conclusion as to what I wanted to end up with. But ultimately, it just kept coming back to pretty much the original sound.
What I was saying is, I think it's a way better version. I think it sounds just much more interesting than
I definitely think it's, you know, there's a, the original did have that emotion, but it was also quite tranquil. I think this is more urgent.
Yeah,
I think the album version's more urgent.
That's a good word for it. There's definitely a sense of urgency. I think we should check it out. And those of you who are score collectors and like Trevor's music, obviously should check out this album, because it actually has a score cue in it that I think is much, much better than the original. So let's check it out. Very awesome theme. I had no idea this was on the album, actually, like, at all, until I listened to it, and I was like, hey, that's pretty amazing. Love the intro.
Oh, cool.
Like,
yeah.
It's like, didn't even know it was the rescue theme from The Guardian, like, until later in the actual track.
Right, right.
So I do want to play one more track, just to give the audience an idea of how eclectic this album is. But before that, talk a little about the cover art. Is that original artwork by somebody?
It's actually by Hannah...
Someone did it, yeah.
Hannah Hooper, who's... in Group Love.
Oh, cool.
And she did the Group Love cover as well. She's,
you know, now that you said that, it
you
is
can
kind
see
of
this.
Similar.
Yeah. She's a phenomenal artist. And it actually, right now, apparently she's hard at work with glue and paint and all kinds of things, getting the Leno,
the backdrop
for the Leno show.
That's really, really cool. So she's doing all the artwork for that. Does she do artwork for all of their shows, or?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. She does all of that.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, this one's called Spider Boogie, and I think it's a fun track. It's the first track on this album, and it'll give you a taste of what's more to come. And I definitely think that you should check this album out. It's on iTunes, and I just got word that the HD tracks are through a website called, HD Tracks. MP3s are available in high resolution through HD Tracks.
Right.
So there
right.
you go.
Thanks for reminding me.
I didn't realize MP3s could have HD.
Yeah, that's what, like, I don't buy any of my music off iTunes because the quality is so low.
So where do you get,
Currently, I try to go to Bandcamp for two reasons. One, the MP3s are higher quality.
Yeah, lossless, right?
And the money goes to the artists versus when you buy things off iTunes, Apple takes a very
they
large
take a big chunk.
Of it.
Yeah.
That and Amazon too, I imagine.
Yeah.
They take a big.
But if you buy direct from the Bandcamp and some, or like going to a band's website, that's direct to the artist. So.
Well, there you go. There you go, everybody. Now you know where to go. But let's check out this track before we move on. It's called Spider Boogie. Saying cool
in the yeah
that was you
yeah
done yeah print it
you're like awesome that's good so awesome actually we have a little music video that's called Anurly and it features you on the guitar can you talk
right.
a little bit about that
yeah it's the title is I grew up in 5 Anurly Road so you know, the thing about this track is there's so many different guitars used for different sounds, and then there's a dobro and baritone guitar and all kinds of different things. So it's a real kind of mixture of different things, and I just thought Anna Lurie wrote for
kind
the
fit.
Title. Yeah.
Well, let's check this out. I think it's very well done, and we'll check out the first minute, but let's check it out. Unfortunately, we're having tech problems again. You can cut back to me, Chris. I think this computer is too slow to play this HD version of this video.
You know, you're probably right.
It's a very high quality version of it. Maybe I can figure out a way to compress it, but what we'll do is, this is going to be released when? When is it going to be released? Is it going to be released on YouTube?
I'm not sure. Ray probably knows, right?
But it will be.
It's going to be very soon because I finished it, so it's ready.
So it's ready to go.
Yeah.
All right. Well, definitely put it up on our site
when
it is
updated.
Released, and we'll post on Twitter for you guys when it is released. It's very, very cool. I think maybe what we'll do instead is to show kind of your skill with the guitar in a video, is to show this master session. There is. There's a master session with you that somebody put on YouTube that I guess is pretty, I don't know how old it is, but they said it's pretty rare and it just shows you about you playing guitar and whatnot. So let's check out this and hopefully it'll give you guys an idea of Trevor's genius. Check it out. We'll be right back. So, like I was saying to you before, it just, you make it look so easy when it's very, I mean, obviously it's very not easy what you're doing. And mm-hmm. You were saying that you have a lot of guitars. You have 60, 70 guitars. Do you just at random times, like, are you just like walking around the house and all of a sudden it's like, oh, I gotta go and play something.
I need number 59.
Yeah, like 54.
Well, as you know, every guitar has a different feel, and even I've got a number of Fender Stratocasters, and each one has a different. And a lot of the guitars were, I was approached and endorsed Alvarez guitars for a number of years, and they said we should put out some signature models. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I had a 12-string signature model that we took ages to put together, and so they would send me versions, and I said, it's almost there, but they wouldn't say send it back, so you know, I've got duplicates of quite a couple of the signature models.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's switch gears a little bit and go into your film scoring world. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you know, your film scores, you've composed a lot of film scores.
Right.
I mean, you said you did 13 with Bruckheimer Films, right?
Right.
Which is no small feat. And they've been big movies. You did Armageddon, and you did a bunch of other ones that were pretty big. What was the one with Will Smith?
Bad Boys 2.
Bad Boys 2. Mm-hmm. And then you did Enemy of the State, too, as well.
And Enemy of the State, that's right.
Those are all Bruckheimer, right?
Yes.
So did you, like, your guitar playing, did it influence you? Obviously influence you in a big way for how you approached the film score.
Oh, very much.
But how did you get into composing, like, from a guitar mindset, how did you get into composing for image?
I was very comfortable working with orchestra, so that wasn't a big shock to me. But I think there was just naturally, for example, it's the lead instrument, as you were asking earlier, do I use guitar in the scores? Mm-hmm. Really as a color most of the time. But in Con Air, it's definitely the kind of the lead instrument of the score.
So do you, you were saying Con Air, so did you start co-composing did you kind of like co-compose at first and then move on to composing scores on your own, or did you always start kind of on your own?
I mean, you know, I didn't set out to do it alone or co-compose. I didn't know what it entailed.
You just had no idea what it was.
I had no idea. In fact, a funny story, when I started the Steven Seagal movie, I really was so green, I didn't know what was going on, and I didn't have the upbringing in film schools that a lot of people have, where you start off, you know, getting your music degree, and then you join a place and get them coffee.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it takes time. I didn't go through that kind of laborious thing.
Lucky dog.
Yeah, exactly. And when I first got the script, I was reading the script, and there were Russian agents involved, and I kept seeing, and I didn't understand, but I didn't want to say anything because I didn't want to act like I didn't know what was going on. But I could never understand who this guy Pov was and why he never spoke. Mm-hmm. But it's point of view. On the camera. and at the end of the movie, I never said anything, but
then you figured it out.
I admit. And things like that happened a lot, you know, but I managed to get through it.
Now
I know everything.
Now you know everything there is to know about it, and it's just a piece of cake.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Like the guitar, you know.
So, you know, I actually found YouTube is an amazing thing. And you just type your name in, and there's like a million videos of you.
Uh-huh.
And one of them was apparently supposed to be this rare TV documentary from a TV show in South Africa and it looks pretty dated. I'm not sure. I mean, because maybe it was in the early turn of the millennium, maybe, or like late 90s. But you talk a little bit about your composing process. And then let's watch a little bit of a little clip and just see if it's changed.
Oh, God, I hope I don't contradict myself.
let's check it out.
...of samples and computers allow the composer to orchestrate creatively, but not on paper.
Well, as I say, I'll start with maybe with a piano sound. In fact, my piano has a program, my acoustic piano, where I can play something and play it back to myself. So in order to arrange it, I'll write a string, like a first violin part, and then maybe a second violin, and then there's violas, cellos, and then double basses. And then melt it all together. Every one of these is an audio track or a track of an instrument. There's more here. So there's literally hundreds of tracks of different things.
For most movies, some sections of the score will be performed by an orchestra.
So do you have a bunch of samples and you kind of experiment a little bit with different pieces of the orchestra, or do you start with a piano theme and go from there?
You know, most times I have an idea in my head outside of what the theme is, which instrument's going to play what. So it's not like I write a piano piece and then orchestrate it. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, whatever I write, I'm thinking that, okay, this is going to be a duet between oboe and clarinet. In fact, there's a piece in The Great Raid where it's just clarinet and oboe. It's a really eerie kind of, where you would probably normally think there's going to be some high, scary strings, but it just provided a unique kind of sound. So I think with the instruments, as opposed to orchestrating afterwards. Not always, but I think that's generally the process I use.
Mm-hmm. You did a score to Remember the Titans, and yeah. I was reading that actually was used in the Obama campaign. Is that true? So did they watch the movie and they're like, oh, I want to use that? And
I never found out, and I was never asked. Huh. And someone said to me, were you pissed off because no one asked you? And I said, had it been somebody else, yeah. I might have been pissed off, but I was pretty happy.
Republicans have a huge problem getting campaign songs because artist wants to endorse them.
Luckily. Really?
No, that's true.
Yeah, that's funny.
I'm sure. How funny is that? Yeah. Well, you know what? I actually found the, it's called Titan Spirit, which I guess is the track that they used.
I think so,
Titan Spirit, or they at least modified.
Well, you know what? It was a combination of Titan Spirit. It was edited pretty well. And they actually, I think, re-edited it from his acceptance speech to him winning, accepting the nomination to winning the nomination.
It's pretty cool that your music was just, you know, they paid honor and tribute to your work.
Yeah, I'm still waiting for a call.
For without the credit.
And maybe a White House invite.
Yeah, invite, you know, or something.
I mean,
you should write a letter to him and say,
it's
dude.
Not like he's busy or anything, you know?
Dude, you can, you know, if you're, your next gig, just invite me over.
You're not allowed to use it on the next campaign.
Unless.
Let's check out a few seconds of the Titan Spirit, and I'm sure you guys will recognize it from the Obama campaign. Here it is. Big movie, very cool movie. It's
a
very heartwarming story.
Good soundtrack, too.
Good soundtrack.
Cool thing.
Talk a little bit about, like, I mean, Jerry Bruckheimer makes big movies. I mean, these are, like, huge movies. Armageddon, for example. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like, were you kind of overwhelmed at the scope of what those movies, I mean, how big, I mean, those movies really were at the beginning? Because this happened to you fairly early on, right? You started working with him very, very quickly.
Yeah, well, I didn't have time to ponder what was happening.
You just had to do it.
It was just, you know, I've got this. I remember going to Jerry early on in Armageddon and saying, Jerry, we've done that much of the score and we've spent that much time and we've got that much score of the left to do and that much time. And he said, you'll do it. So, you know, on the one hand, it was great for him to have that confidence, but it was always a lot of hard work.
Yeah, Armageddon is, I remember seeing that movie, that came out in what, like 1997?
Something like that.
98?
Yeah, late 90s. Something like that, yeah.
And I remember it being a big movie in the theater when it came out. I mean, I was in high school at the time.
Right.
I was just graduating high school at the time. And one of the things that I know that all of us remembered, especially you guys that are score fans, was the music. It plays a mm-hmm. huge role in, you know, the epicness of the film. All the patriotic dolly shots and... you know, all of that stuff are all encompassed in the music. Did you get it right like the first time, or did you have to do a lot of rewrites?
Well, because I was so new at scoring, you know, even though I'd done Con Air with Jerry and it was fine, I'd only done that in one other movie, the Seagal movie. Mm-hmm. So when it came to Armageddon, he wasn't sure whether I could get through it, especially as Michael Bay as well, who's a pretty hefty handful.
So I've heard.
Yeah. And it was quite interesting because what I had to do is write the theme. I suggested to make him comfortable. I would write the theme, a theme. And he was looking for what he could termed, I think, the world anthem, something like that. So I wrote the Armageddon theme and sent it to him, and he was happy with it. And he said, well, maybe we can put a team together. And I said, Jerry, you have Cinderella and you have the Ugly Sisters. I might be the Ugly Sisters, but the theme I've written is Cinderella, and you can't have one without the other. And that's kind of what happened with that. But it became easy because all the themes, like we were discussing earlier, I pretty much wrote before we had to put it to picture, so there was no temp problems, and it was pretty smooth. Hectic, but smooth.
I mean, that's pretty awesome considering you were very new.
Yeah,
kind of a new composer at that time.
Right, I would definitely.
Because you hear horror stories of guys that come into the film composing business and they're just overwhelmed and like they go nuts because they don't know what they're doing. But it seems like you really knew from the get-go what you wanted.
Yeah, I've seen the imploding. I've heard about the imploding. I just, for some reason, I never got stressed to the point of, oh my God, how am I going to do this? You know, you just plod on and you get through it.
One of the fans, at least when I was posting that you were coming on Twitter, really liked the Armageddon scene of the launch. So we'll play a little bit of the launch and talk about your other stuff.
Cool.
There you go.
Just beware of time.
Oh, yeah.
I address you tonight not as the President of the United States, not as the leader of a country, but as a citizen of humanity. We are faced with the very gravest of challenges. The Bible calls this day Armageddon, the end of all things. And yet, for the first time in the history of the planet, a species has the technology to prevent its own extinction. All of you praying with us need to know that everything that can be done to prevent this disaster is being called into service. The human thirst for excellence and knowledge, every step up the ladder of science, every adventurous reach into space, all of our combined modern technologies and imaginations, even the wars that we fought have provided us the tools to wage this terrible battle. Through all the chaos that is our history, through all of the wrongs and the discord, through all of the pain and suffering, through all of our times, there is one thing that has nourished our souls and elevated our species above its origins, and that is our courage. The dreams of an entire planet are focused tonight on those 14 brave souls traveling into the heavens.
That man's not a salesman. That's your daddy.
And may we all, citizens the world over, see these events through. Godspeed and good luck to you.
Freedom crew. Independence crew.
How you feeling?
Good, you know.
So you kind of get a sense of the main theme. The main theme is present there, the Armageddon theme. Am I right?
It's leading to it.
Okay.
Yeah, these are the kind of sub-themes. But I think the first theme that we heard was, I'd say, the second most important theme in the movie.
So, you know, to give, because we're running out of time, and I kind of want to give, you have a very eclectic repertoire of music, and I think that, you know, there are a lot of different types of themes in your score music as well. And one of them is that I want to demonstrate for the audience is National Treasure, your National Treasure Book of Secrets main title, which starts off with a very cool violin sound. Very cool, like very light sound, and it's like absolutely gorgeous. So let's check this out real quick, and it'll give you a completely opposite idea of Trevor's work. Here we go. There you have it, folks. Trevor Rabin, amazing composer and musician. We are so honored to have you on our show.
Thank you for having
me. We know how busy you are. You'll have to come back whenever, at some point.
I'll bring my son.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be really cool. And you guys can jam in the studio.
Exactly.
Well, anyway, guys, if you want to check this out, check us out on iTunes. All this stuff will be on Trigla, so you can go and check out the YouTube videos. And Trevor actually has a very nice repertoire on Spotify. If you want to check out his stuff there. So, go on to iTunes, rate our stuff, find us on Twitter. We'll see you next week. Thanks so much for coming, Trevor.
Thanks.
Thank you.